Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab Supplement for op-amp stability. This lab will walk through detailed calculations, SPI simulations, and real-world measurements that greatly help to reinforce the concepts established in the stability video series. The detailed calculation portion of this lab can be done by hand, but calculation tools such as MathCAD or Excel can help greatly. The simulation exercises can be performed in any SPI simulator, since Texas Instruments provides generic SPICE models of the op-amps used in this lab. However, the simulations are most conveniently done in Tina TI, which is a free SPICE simulator available from the TI website. Tina's simulation schematics are embedded in the presentation. Finally, the real-world measurements are made using a printed circuit board, or PCB, provided by TI. If you have access to standard lab equipment, you can make the necessary measurements with any oscilloscope, function generator, Bode plotter, and plus or minus 15-volt power supply. However, we highly recommend the National Instruments Virtual Bench. The Virtual Bench is an all-in-one test equipment solution which connects to a computer over USB or Wi-Fi and provides power supply rails, analog signal generator and oscilloscope channels, and a 5.5-digit multimeter for convenient and accurate measurements. This lab is optimized for use with the virtual bench. In experiment 1, we'll determine the phase margin, and therefore the stability, of a buffer circuit which is being used to drive a large capacitive load. We'll determine the phase margin by observing the transient overshoot as well as the AC transfer characteristic. First, calculate the phase margin and percentage overshoot for the circuit shown here, using the techniques and equations given in the stability video series. Use the plots given on the next slide. This circuit uses the OPA-277. In order to perform the calculations, you need to know the percent overshoot versus load capacitance for that device shown on the top left. Then use the plot on the right to determine the phase margin from that percentage overshoot. Enter your answers in the table at the bottom of the slide. The solutions are already provided to allow you to check your work. The next step is to run a SPICE simulation analysis for the transient overshoot. The necessary Tina TI simulation schematic is embedded in this slide set. Simply double-click the icon to open it. To run the analysis, click Analysis, then Transient, and run the analysis from 100 microseconds to 250 microseconds. The input is a 20 millivolt peak, 10 kHz square wave. You should see a result similar to this. Use the simulated percentage overshoot of 40% to calculate the phase margin, which comes out to 31 degrees. Next, run a SPICE simulation analysis for the AC transfer characteristic. This will allow us to see the op-amp's AC peaking, which is another indicator of phase margin. Use the same Tina TI simulation schematic as before. To run the analysis, click Analysis, then AC Analysis, then AC Transfer Characteristic. Run the analysis from 10 kHz to 10 MHz. You should see a result similar to this. The 6.7 dB of peaking results in a phase margin of approximately 27 degrees. Make sure to disable the DC power supply before setting up the test PCB. In the Virtual Bench software, click the power button in the DC power supply area to turn off the power. Check the front panel of the Virtual Bench unit to make sure the LEDs are off. Also ensure that the function generator is off. To prepare the test board for the measurement, install the jumpers and devices on circuit 5, as shown here. Install JMP17, JMP18, JMP19, JMP20, JMP48, and JMP50, as well as the OPA-277 in socket U7. This slide shows the full schematic for circuit 5 on the TI Precision Labs test board. You will use this circuit to measure the stability of the OPA-277. For the test board to function properly, it is important that you only install jumpers and devices in circuit 5. Do not install any jumpers or devices in any other circuits on the PCB. Remove any jumpers or devices from the unused circuits and store them in the storage area at the bottom of the test board. This gives the connection diagram between the TI Precision Labs test board and the National Instruments Virtual Bench. Connect the provided power cable to the DC power supply of the virtual bench and power connector J4 on the test board. Connect VN1 on the test board to virtual bench oscilloscope channel 1, and VN2 on the test board to the virtual bench FGen, our function generator. Connect VOUT1 on the test board to virtual bench oscilloscope channel 2. Next, apply power to the National Instruments virtual bench and connect it to your computer with a USB cable. The hardware should be detected as a virtual CD drive, and you can run the virtual bench software directly from the drive. Once the software opens, configure the software as follows. Set the time scale to 1 microsecond per division, with the acquisition mode set to auto. Enable channels 1 and 2 on the oscilloscope, and set them to 1x DC coupled mode, 10 millivolts per division. Enable the function generator and set up the signal as follows. 10 kHz frequency, 20 millivolts peak to peak, 0 volts offset, 50% duty cycle square wave. Set the plus 25 volt power supply to plus 15 volts, 0.1 amps. Set the minus 25 volt power supply to minus 15 volts, 0.1 amps. Press the power button to turn on the power supply rails. Move the display window to the rising edge of the square wave. This allows you to observe the overshoot and ringing of the op-amp output. Use cursors to measure the amount of overshoot. The expected measurement results are shown here. The measured overshoot of 55% results in a phase margin of 21 degrees. Your results may vary slightly. Before continuing, please close the virtual bench software. The next step requires additional Bode Analyzer software. Install the software, then run it by clicking Start, All Programs, Bode Analyzer, Bode Analyzer. In the Configuration panel, set the power supply to plus and minus 15 volts, 0.1 amps. Press the green button to turn on the power. Set the FGEN amplitude to 0.02 volts and DC offset to 0 volts. Set the start frequency to 10 kHz and the end frequency to 10 MHz. Set the number of points to average to 10 and the number of points per decade to 30. Press Start to run the Bode Analyzer. You should see a result similar to this. Enable the cursor, then drag the cursor to the maximum value to measure the AC peaking. In this measurement, AC peaking of 8 dB resulted in a phase margin of 23 degrees. Your results may vary slightly. Now compare the phase margin results from your hand calculations, transient and AC response simulations, and transient and AC response measurements. While there is some slight variation to the results, the phase margin values compare very well at approximately 27 degrees. In experiment 2, we'll use an isolation resistor to increase the phase margin of the circuit from experiment 1 and therefore improve its stability. To determine the value of isolation resistor RISO, we must first know the open loop AC response of the circuit. Here we show the TINA TI simulation schematic and AC response results, which you can verify using the embedded file. To measure the phase margin, find the frequency where the gain measures 0 dB. Then measure the phase at that same frequency, which in this example is 20 degrees. For best results, RISO should create a zero in the loop response 20 dB greater than the frequency where the open loop gain intersects with the closed loop gain. This circuit is a buffer with a closed loop gain of 0 dB, so the zero should occur at 20 dB. The open loop gain is equal to 20 dB at 92 kHz. Use this value and the load capacitance to calculate RISO, which is 786 ohms in this example. 787 ohms is the nearest standard value resistor. Let's now simulate the transient overshoot with RISO included in the circuit. As before, click Analysis, then Transient to run the simulation. Run the analysis from 100 microseconds to 250 microseconds. The input is a 20 millivolts peak, 10 kHz square wave. You should see results similar to this. With RISO added to the circuit, the overshoot was reduced to only 4.7%. This results in a phase margin of 65 degrees, indicating a stable circuit. Let's now rerun the overshoot measurement, this time with RISO. The jumper setup is almost the same. The only change is to remove JMP18, which connects the isolation resistor of 787 ohms. The test board setup remains the same as before. Install circuit 5 only, and store any unused jumpers and devices in the storage area at the bottom of the test board. This slide gives the new connection diagram between the TI Precision Labs test board and the National Instruments Virtual Bench. Connect the provided power cable on the DC power supply of the virtual bench and the power connector J4 on the test board. Connect VN2 on the test board to the virtual bench FGEN. Connect VOUT1 on the test board to virtual bench oscilloscope channel 1 to measure the load voltage, and connect VOUT2 on the test board to virtual bench oscilloscope channel 2 to measure the unloaded op-amp output voltage. The virtual bench setup is almost the same as before. Only change the time scale to 5 microseconds per division. All other settings remain the same. Use cursors to measure the amount of overshoot. You should see results similar to this. With RISO, the measured unloaded output overshoot was reduced to 12.5%, resulting in a phase margin of approximately 58 degrees, which indicates a stable circuit. As an additional experiment, measure the transient response again with JMP48 installed and removed. This will connect and disconnect the 1K load resistor from the circuit. As you can see, the load voltage changes dramatically if the circuit is loaded or unloaded. In fact, when loaded, the circuit with RISO shows attenuation of approximately 50%. This is simply due to the voltage divider effect of RISO and the load resistance. For the final experiment, we'll analyze a circuit which uses RISO as well as a dual feedback network to achieve stability as well as output voltage accuracy. To select the components of the dual feedback network, use the equations given on this slide. For this example, RF was chosen to be 78.7 kiloohms, and CF was chosen to be 150 picofarads. Next, run a SPICE simulation analysis for the transient overshoot with dual feedback. The necessary TINA TI simulation schematic is embedded in this slide set. Simply double-click the icon to open it. To run the analysis, click Analysis Transient and run the analysis from 0 milliseconds to 2 milliseconds. The input is a 1 volts peak, 1 kHz square wave. You should see results similar to this. As you can observe, in this configuration, the loaded output voltage matches very well with the input. To achieve this, the unloaded output voltage, VOPA, must increase to compensate for the attenuation caused by RISO and the load resistance. Again, make sure to disable the DC power supply before setting up the test PCB. In the virtual bench software, click the power button in the DC power supply area to turn off the power. Check the front panel of the virtual bench unit to make sure the LEDs are off. Also ensure that the function generator is off. To prepare the test board for measurement, install the jumpers and devices on circuit 6 as shown here. Install JMP21, JMP22, JMP23, JMP49, and JMP51. Install the OPA277 in socket U8. This slide shows the full schematic for circuit 6 on the TI Precision Labs test board. You will use this circuit to measure the transient behavior of the OPA277 in a dual feedback configuration. For the test board to function properly, it is important that you only install jumpers and devices in circuit 6. Do not install any jumpers or devices in any other circuits on the PCB. Remove any jumpers or devices from the unused circuits and store them in the storage area at the bottom of the test board. The cable connections are the same as in experiment 2. Do not make any changes to the cables. The virtual bench setup is almost the same as before. Only change the time scale to 100 microseconds per division. All other settings should remain the same. You should see results similar to this. As you can see, the load voltage remains accurate even with changing load due to the compensation provided by the dual feedback network. The unloaded op-amp output voltage must increase as the load resistance decreases to minimize the output voltage divider effect. That concludes this lab. Thank you for your time.